ça, si je peux modifier la taille.
So good morning to everyone. Thank you very much, Professor Dazen, for inviting me there. I'm super happy to be among you. And as our colleague has just said, I'm a bit new in the game story, so it will be my first presentation on CNET. I've been previously working on funerary texts a lot and on, socio-anthropological topics, but it has always been a topic that has attracted me, so I'm super happy to be there, but do not hesitate to share your opinions, advice, for I'm new. So I will talk to you about the game of CNET, which is for sure the best known board game of Egyptian antiquity, and both for researchers and the general public, with many modern adaptations. As you can see, I've never tried them. Concerning the academic world, the main studies have been conducted by Timothy Kendall, mainly, then by Edgar Pusch, and finally by Peter Piccione, who appears now as an authority on the subject, let's say. And very recently, of course, the publication Ancient Egyptians at Play has provided a very, very useful synthesis on the topic, putting particular emphasis on the transmission of the CNET game to Cyprus, Levant, and Nubia. So as far as I do not really know how familiar you are with this Egyptian game, I have chosen to present you briefly its evolution through time, using, of course, the contribution of the studies that precede me, right, while trying, I hope, to raise some new questions on it, at least new lights, maybe from the side, since it seems to me that the role of the CNET has perhaps not always been well understood. I mean, at least you can understand it maybe otherwise, another way. Sometimes maybe the interpretations were a bit hasty, and many aspects of the game still deserve to be explored. So first thing, what is a CNET? So it's a board game. Here you see a box, which is typical from the time from New Kingdom, but you can also have slabs or graffiti. a board game with 30 squares, organized, of course, in 10 squares. The game can be played on a small table or directly on the floor, especially in case of graffiti, between two players, each having 5 to 7 playing pieces, depending on the time, and whose progress on the board obviously depends on the throwing of sticks of a pair of jacks that you can see there. They come from the Medina, these ones, again depending on the period. There is a general agreement, let's say, that pieces are moved on the board in a Z-shaped path, as you can see with this drawing from a representation of a CNET in a tomb chapel. That is a bit strange, by the way, mais bon. A drawing made by Henri Wild, who's an Egyptologist that we will talk about a little bit later on. So the CNET could go back in the night of prehistory, let's say, to the early pre-dynastic period, to the beginning of the 4th millennium BC, with this supposed board that was found in the tomb of Nagada I. Nagada I is the name of an Egyptian culture and the time and the period at the same time. A board that was found in the cemetery of El Mahasna quite a long time ago in the north of Abydos. And note that this tomb, I think it's important to underline this, is a tomb of a woman being buried with a child, by the way. And one of the richest tombs of the cemetery. So This is the actual display in the museum, but in fact the supposed playing pieces were not found, of course, like this, and were scattered in the tomb. So some researchers believe that this object is not a board game, but might be an offering table. It has also been underlined that the board would not have its canonical form, because you see that you don't have the three rows of 10 squares, but you have less squares. To me, I don't like the idea of canonical, because we are in a period of formation of ancient Egyptian culture. It's pre-dynastic, when everything settles on and nothing is already like in the frame, you know? So I'm not sure it's really an argument, and I don't know how to explain the grid that is on the table if it's an offering table, because in Egypt, we, as far as I know, we don't do them with the grid. So I would be tempted to say this might be a proto-senet, let's call it like this, but the debate remains totally open. In any case, the oldest attestation of the game's name, Senet, can be found in a list of offerings from Prince Rahotep's tomb. Just for the pleasure, I added the detail of the wonderful statue of Prince Rahotep that is kept in the Cairo Museum. So we are under the fourth dynasty, and you can see that Senet appears amongst other games, like the game of Mehen and the game of Men that you see here. So this name Senet means the passing, or to pass in ancient Egyptian, and for some commentators, especially for Pitione, it would be a religious allusion, and I quote him, the passage from the Ba to the Duat, the Ba being, to be really simple, the soul, well, of course it doesn't work like this, but let's say so, and the Duat being, again, it's very complicated, we could write a thesis on this, but let's say the hereafter. So the passage of the soul in the hereafter. But to be honest, I wonder, and again the question is absolutely open, if there would not be a modern a priori based on our own acceptance of the word passing, in fact. Because as far as I know, the other Egyptian games, when we know their names, the name seems to be rather based, let's say, on their morphology. Like here you have a Mehen game from the first dynasty, so it's also a very, very ancient game. The word Mehen means to be coiled. And you see that the board is a snake that is coiled, like this. Of course, it's a bit tricky, because the word Mehen also designates Senet as, from the beginning, religious meaning in its name, but I would rather go for the gaming option, let's say. During the Old Kingdom also appear the first representations of the Senet game in the chapels of private tombs, most of them being in the Memphite necropolis. And we have there, for these scenes of the Old Kingdom, two main types of scenes. So you can have, first type is this one, you have two players, two players. Of course, this shape, Maria must maybe recall what we have just saw before, mais bon. Two players, two men who, and it's important to say, two men who held a subaltern position in the tomb. By subaltern, I mean they are not the deceased, or they are not the family of the deceased. These are the persons who are in the position of doing something for the deceased. So they are the subaltern. So two men, two subaltern, playing against each other and talking about the game. So I propose a traduction there. It's not sure at all. In fact, these texts might seem super easy to translate, but they are not, even if they are very short, because we don't even know how to read them, in which sense. So it's a bit complicated, but you have the general context. They are talking about the game that they are playing. And Pitione rightly notes that this kind of scenes often take place near or among dance and music scenes, just like you have here, you have a concert. To him, these scenes are actual, the dancing and the music scenes are actual rituals, meaning really performed on Earth, dedicated to the goddess Hathor, that would be performed during the funerals. And so, because it's represented next to that, the Senet should be played at the occasion of these rituals. But the thing is that the very nature of the scenes in tomb chapels is in fact extremely difficult to understand precisely and to know on which plan you are. I mean, in a tomb chapel in ancient Egypt, you can have scenes that seem to depict our world in an idealized way. And we think that maybe it means that the dead, the deceased, wants to find this back in the hereafter. We find scenes that are strictly funerary, but they are very rare, like the transportation of the funerary material to the tomb. And we find scenes that are in between, like the agricultural scenes, for instance, that at the same time settle the environment of the living, let's say, but is also connected to the preparation of food offering. So you see, we have, let's say, to be generalistic, three types of scene, and we don't know for these ones where we are. You can't say these things really happen. It's not possible to say so. We just don't know. So I would rather not draw a hasty conclusion. And to me, the connection of these Senet games and the music and dance scene begin to draw, let's say, to draw an environment dedicated to pleasures. And we will go back to this theme a little bit later. So the second possibility for the Senet games seen in the tomb of the Old Kingdom, much rarer than the first, is when the dead that you can recognize to his heroic size, so he's bigger, as you can see, plays against a character who is that time, again a subaltern here, and who is considered as being alive. It's complicated, but we consider that all these scenes are supposedly alive, at least not the same world as the deceased is. Do you follow me? Yes? Okay. Do not hesitate to tell if I'm not that clear. So you have here two examples, and you see, I think you see here more clearly that the Senet game is doing visually a link in between this side of the image, the deceased and his wife, and this side of the image, supposedly living or idealized living or something like this. So, always keeping in mind that we don't know, and that it's only hypothesis. So, Piccione has proposed, and I follow him there with cautiousness, that we might have there a representation of a game that actually took place in between the living and the dead. Why do I say so? Because the fact to link the two plants with an object is also to be seen on food offering scenes, where you have the bread that does the link exactly the same way in the two plants. And we know that food offerings was really done in the tomb chapels because we found it. So, okay. Second, because we can find Senet boards engraved on the ground, in the vicinity of some tomb chapels, also in the Memphis necropolis, or even funerary temples. But once again, we must remain super cautious, because for the thing to be like proven, then the Senet boards should be contemporary or not too far in time with the construction of the tomb. And as you know, it's a bit difficult to date the graffiti, even if the, for instance, this might go for Old Dacian, Old Kingdom, or Middle Kingdom. Anyway, so you see that we can have a lot of ideas, but we have to go really step by step. And by chance, the link between the world of the dead and the living through the Senet is expressed in the following period, during the Middle Kingdom, among what we call the coffin texts. So the coffin texts are, do you know? It's a collection of formulas, sometimes inherited from the pyramid text, sometimes new, that there are a bit more than 1,000. They are written inside the wooden coffins of the members of provincial elite during the Middle Kingdom. So among these spells, we have the spell 405, and this is the passage in which the great tribunal, the tribunal of the gods, expresses itself about the deceased. So the great tribunal, which is in the field, says, "Let him sing, let him dance, let him receive the ornaments, let him play senet with the ones who are on earth. It is his voice which is heard, but he cannot be seen. Let him go to his house, that he may visit his children forever and ever." So you have here twice the idea of the game making the connection in between the world. Note that the spell 405 is known by only two occurrences. We know 200 to 300 coffins with texts, and only two occurrences. And only one of these two occurrences mentions the Senet. A point has particularly attracted my attention, because this coffin on which stands the only mention of the Senet in the spell is that of a woman. So is that significant? Maybe. Maybe not. Maybe not, because the personal pronoun that is used there is F. It's a masculine pronoun, so it shows that the text has been fought for men, but we only find it on the coffin of a woman. And at the same time, only one coffin also, again, represents a senet among what Egyptologists call les frises d'objets. So I just show an example. They are frises d'objets, so the frises d'objets are depictions of the objects you wish to bring with you in the hereafter, and that you depict inside of the coffin. And this coffin of it, in which the senet appears, a strange senet, by the way, but it's written that it's a senet, so that's fine. It's a treasure for Egyptologists, this frises d'objets, because you have the drawing and you have the name. So, I mean, this coffin is also a coffin of a woman. So, I mean, I don't know. And the Senet is represented among jewelry, mirrors, so objects related, let's say, in other spheres at least, to eroticism, fertility, sexuality. So there is something there. And precisely, just before passage in the spell 405, the court of gods, the tribunal of the gods, which wishes that the dead could experience sexual pleasure in the hereafter. By the way, I can't resist the pleasure to show you the world. It's here, sexual pleasure is there. It's Nejem. Alors Nejem, here you have it's a fruit. Here, this sign is a fruit, which is super sweet. So it has to be read Nejem, and when you add a M, it's like a superlative, so Nejem Emet, the super sweet, which is, I like that. Okay. So so in the same spirit, and if you allow me a little leap in time, I'm also thinking of the representations of Ramses III playing the Senet in his harem, that one can find in Medinet Habu temple under the New Kingdom. And there are two scenes, in fact, I only show you one. and they are super heavy with sexual innuendos, super, super heavy, and they are and he's playing the Senate, and he touches the princesses, as you can see, which is like super hot for the Egyptian yes, for the Egyptian thinking. So there would be in fact many other elements that I cannot present to you today to underline the link between Senate and eroticism. But this is an aspect that I believe maybe has been a little bit underestimated, and I'm just beginning to see the outlines. It's not clear in my mind for the moment, but I think there is really something to pull and to think about. So let's go back to the Middle Kingdom and to a context that is totally different, with this exceptional boat model. So we will be in something very different from what we just say. It's a model that is dated from the 12th dynasty, from a tomb in the necropolis of Beni Hassan. So each time I put the map so you can situate yourself. So as you can see, there are two shields on the near the cabin, and also here a Nubian archer. So there are obviously soldiers. This man, and among these men, two are playing a senet. Alors, I know that from here it might look like another game, it might look like a man. By the way, the museum, I don't remember where it's kept, but the museum consider it as a man. But if you are a bit sucks, you see that in fact there are the lines, and I have a drawing to show you just later on. So it's a senet, it's not a man. You have the 30 squares, and it's quite clear. So what seems rather interesting here is to underline that the habit of playing among soldiers is not only to be seen under the Roman domination. Of course, we have in mind the board games found in the fortress of Abu Shah, for instance, on the Red Sea. But it's an habit that can be dated, let's say, at least since the Middle Kingdom. There is also an example of a senet in the fortress of Buhen in Nubia. So here you discover the drawing of this model boat before it was damaged, let's say. You see that the player here is pushing a playing piece that has disappeared, unfortunately, on the model now. And it's quite clear that there is the Senet grid. This very beautiful drawing has been made by somebody that I like quite much, is Henri Wilde. So he's a Swiss Egyptologist that is particularly well known for his work on dance, but he has also collected a huge documentation on games, and he has never used them, in fact, for publication. It happens that his archives are kept at the IFAO, and where I've been working, and I happen to be a very good friend of the archivist, which helps. So I have been lucky enough to explore Henri Wilde's documentation, and we can really find nuggets in these archives. So I show you just a few things. These documents, for instance, to my knowledge, it describes two Senet games that I have not been able to find elsewhere, and I think they are from his personal collection. One Senet game is known from the personal collection of Henri Wilde, but I wonder if there is not a mixed up, by the way. But this one doesn't seem to be known elsewhere, and I'm pretty sure that there should be in the basement of IFAO also the games themselves. Here you also have a note. The same, I've not been able, but if you have infos, tell me to find that in the documentation. It's a fragment of Senet on pottery kept in the Museum of Port Said, so Museum of Egypt that have no catalogues. I mean, there is a catalogue going on, but it's still under work, let's say. So, I mean, one can see the very interest of working on these archives, and I'll try to explore them a little bit deeper in the following months. So to go back to the game itself, you can see from this drawing that some boards are inscribed. In fact, some squares of some boards bear inscriptions. And from the earliest time, the inscription concerns mainly, not only of course, but mainly four squares. And under the Old and the Middle Kingdom at least, and seem to have a ludic meaning, let's say, only. So you have the sign Nefer, good, in square 26, an X in square 27, the number 3 in square 28, and the number 2 in square 29. By the way, you notice the change of orientation in between Old Kingdom and Middle Kingdom, and in the New Kingdom it will be reversed again. You also notice from the first example that the first senet is a graffito. And as I said previously, some senets are quickly drawn on the ground in different contexts, but maybe for some of them in the context of teams of men. For instance, in the Abydos, senets were found engraved on stones near the funerary structures of the site. So you have there the cenotaph of Sesostris the second, cenotaph of Sesostris the third, so under the Middle Kingdom. Of course, we might think, okay, they might have been engraved there for religious purposes, but most of the commentators consider that they have been more simply, let's say, used by the builders of these very structures. Thus, players from maybe lower social classes, just like the soldiers we mentioned before. In fact, the question of social belonging of the players, as well as their gender, by the way, and the use of the game in lower social classes, I mean by that non-upper elite sphere, is an aspect that has been relatively neglected in the previous studies on the Senet, because the Senet is mainly approached through a religious prism, with notable exception of ancient Egyptians at play, of course, that underlines the social aspects. But I think there is a part to explore there, and in this spirit, and going to the next period of time, the New Kingdom, the site of Deir el-Medina would be particularly interesting to start with. So we are there in the village, so the village is here, sorry, in the village and necropolis, the necropolis is there, of the craftsmen who built and decorated the tombs of the nearby Valley of the Kings and Valley of the Queens. So the inhabitants form a very particular community. I mean, some of them are super high-level artists, they are selected for their skills, but some of them are, let's say, carrier, or you say when you dig the graves?
Quarries.
Voilà, quarries, yes. So it's, let's say, quite mixed, but it's very, very particular, mm-hmm. but it's not the upper elite connected to political and religious power, it's something else. And it's this site, I don't know if you know it, it's a pure treasure for daily life studies. We know them, we know their families, we know who likes who have sex with who. We have letters for that, I know that, machin, nah, nah, okay. So it's really something incredible, Deir el-Medina. And it happens that in the basement of the IFAO, we find a huge number of objects from the ancient excavations of Deir el-Medina, because it was Bernard Bruyère, French excavator, who led the biggest work on the site. And these objects are still under the process of their inventory, so in fact they are still unknown. And among them, there is what seemed to be Senet boards. So interestingly, I found this one totally by chance in a box that was supposed to contain fragments of statues and of walls, which shows that the corpus often suffers from misidentification of the objects, in fact. So I have to open all the boxes of the basement. I can tell you this is among the mice and everything. Anyway, yes. So as far as I appear to be quite lucky, a number of other possible boards are still among the thousands of items stored on the site itself. In a storehouse that has been opened for the first time after decades last February. My friends were super excited to send me some pictures. I don't know if you see well, but on these fragments there are grids. So I've not seen them for real. I will go to see them inshallah in January or February next season. They told me there are also playing pieces, so it seems that in this storehouse we can have a few things that are quite promising. And going back to the archives, because I'm super lucky, it happens that in Wild's archives, precisely, there is a drawing of the board that was found in this box. As you can see, it's just the same. And a little note that attests that it was brought back from Deir el Medina to the palace of Ifao in February 56. And going a little bit further in Bruyère's publication and also in his excavation journals that are unpublished, you realize that this one could be one of the Senet found in the village houses or even at the Station du Col, la Station du Col being an intermediate place of resting in between the village and the Valley of the Kings. When the teams were working, they stayed there for a few days. So, again, in the context of team of men. But these senet, obviously used by the living, let's say, are very different, always cautious, are very different from those found in tombs at the same time under the New Kingdom and sometimes on the very same site, even in Deir el Medina. It happens that the senet boards belonging to the dead trousseau takes then the form of a box, as you can see, a box with a drawer for obviously storing pawns, sticks and or jack. And another game is frequently found under the senet boxes, under or up, because it depends on what you consider the main side. But here you see you have a game of 20 that is connected on the other side with the senet. You know the game of the 20 squares imported from the Near East, certainly during the domination of the Hyksos under the Second Intermediate Period. So a cultural transfer. Of course, the most famous game of 20 is the royal game of Ur that you maybe have in mind. It happens also that during the second part of the second millennium, so second part of the New Kingdom, the inscriptions in the squares become, let's say, more complex, figurative, and seem to take gradually a religious turn, so at least in appearance. As you can see with this table, so I've chosen the example of square 27, because it's important to me, you'll understand later why. 27 that was occupied, you remember, before by an X, a cross, that will turn aquatic with the sign mu for the water. I thought about it, but I think no. If you are if you think about your, yeah, no, I don't know, maybe.
Nothing, no.
Yeah. Then turns into the genius of the flood, Api, or to an hippopotamus, that's also, of course, linked to the Nile, and that has strong religious meaning as well. And going further into religious consideration, two texts from the New Kingdom have been widely discussed. The Great Game text, of course, or texts, if you consider it as a genre, and the chapter 17 of the Book of the Dead. Mm. So, the Great Game text is known by three different sources, all dated under the reign of Ramses III, including, by the way, a papyrus in Torino Museum, which also bears representations of two senet boards, all squares being decorated, which is almost never the case on actual Senate, but maybe on this one. The one from the Wild archive, you remember, we saw that already. You see that all the squares that remain at least are inscribed there. Anyway, the text of the Great Game text opens with a clearly funerary formula. So we are in a funerary sphere for sure. Then gives the main stages of the game when the player speaks in the first person and passes through the different squares that are called the houses, Peru, of the deities, by the way, and obviously winning in the end. Well, in the text are several references to a boat trip marked by the different stages that are represented by the squares. So during this journey, the player is guided and protected by the god Mehen, the snake who embodies the game of the same name. But what is important to have in mind is that the game of Mehen, as at that time, fell into disuse since the Old Kingdom, since 1,000 years. And in the books of the underworld, especially the Book of the Gates, the Mehen snake appears to protect the sun god in his bark. So I've said that in the Great Game text there is an allusion to a journey in a boat. And yes, Mehen protects the sun boat in his bark, but with no link in this text, no link to the game. Mehen in the books of the underworld is just a protecting god, he's not a gaming god. That's here. So in the case of the Great Game text, the course of the game is therefore quite clearly associated with the solar journey, that is, yes, in the case of the Great Game text, not elsewhere, in this case, which is at the same time the dead man's journey. On this is quite clear. So I therefore agree with Piccione on this point, but maybe not on the detail of his analysis of the text, which is super complicated and might be need to be reconsidered. And I do not agree also with the fact that the solar journey would be in itself, as an effect of reflection, perceived as a moving on the game board. I mean, it's the one way doesn't go with the other, especially that in this documentation, the books of the netherworld, there is no allusion to games. It's not that. And the sun has to go through 12 hours, not 30, etc. So, I mean, what might be true on the one end, okay, in the case of the Great Game text, which is super specific, the moving on the board is solar and connected to the sun journey, but the sun journey is not, except maybe there, I don't know, is not perceived as moving on a game board. Mm-hmm. And we can go further. According to him, the Great Game text refers to an initiation of the dead by the god Mehen, and even more, the game would also be used by the living in initiation rituals, revealing to players the secrets of the afterlife, the living players, let's say. And it is totally true that in the Great Game text, there are several mentions of knowledge, a knowledge that is acquired by the player, just like that. I know their names. There is nothing that a scribe with knowledge ignores. Mehen has instructed me. Of course, knowing the names, it's to have power on the named entities, let's say. But the thing is that the term, the word rer, to know, as well as the verb meter, to instruct, are super common in the vocabulary, and they do not imply any ritualized context that defines, in essence, initiation. So I think the text refers to instruction, but it does not refer to initiation. I mean, not clearly, I don't say it's not, I just say it doesn't say it. moreover, claiming on the basis of this text that the Senate could have been used by the living to initiate them to the secrets of the afterlife is, I don't know where it comes from, to be honest, because the text simply does not deal with the living, and because also the very existence of religious initiation in ancient Egypt, especially concerning funerary knowledge, is still under debate. It's a super complicated question. So I do not say that Piquion is wrong, not at all. I just say that what he proposes, even if it's super challenging and interesting in this question of initiation, cannot be proven with these arguments and has to be investigated a little bit more. And the same caution might be required when approaching the famous chapter 17 of the Book of the Dead, that also refers to the Senet. So, the title, by the way, the title chosen by Piccione to build his argumentation is the one of the papyrus of Nebseni. In fact, you can have variations from a papyrus to another. So, formula for going out by day, transforming in any form desired to be taken, playing the Senet, being seated in the pavilion, a living bar, so a living soul, by N, N is the name of the deceased, after he mourned, meaning he died, this is good for the one who does it on earth. Alors, sometimes note that the vignette accompanying this chapter show the deceased in his pavilion playing, in this case, playing with, being accompanied by his wife. So this chapter is also often quoted to show that the Senet was actually used in funerary rituals in order to assess the afterlife, thanks to the sentence, it is effective for the one who does it on earth. And for sure, if you take it like this, you could say, the Senet is mentioned just before, they should play the Senet on earth. But in fact, I think that this sentence refers more to pronouncing the text than to actually do what is mentioned in the title, unless you think that you also have to perform transformation in gods, going out of the necropolis and things like this, really on earth. And also because in other versions, this sentence, this is good for the one who does it on earth, is placed elsewhere. Just like here, it's written there, and just after that, you have it makes happen all the words pronounced by Atum. So it's really about pronunciation and reading, I think, the text more than doing what is described, let's say, in the title. It is also often said that chapter 17 is further evidence that the course on the board is perceived as the path of the sun, or even reversed, as we said, that the sun leads its path on the Senet board. But in fact, returning again to the Egyptian text, we see this is not the case at all. In fact, the formula does not, you don't have to read all of it, just the red things will be okay. The formula does not deal with the journey of the sun at all. It deals with its first appearance through cosmogonical aspects. The deceased is identified there with a creator god. I am the great god who comes into being. It's not about the path, it's about the first light, the first apparition of life, let's say. And so, no path of the sun, but also no senet. No senet at all in the body of the chapter 17, only in the title. And in fact, the body of chapter 17 is oftenly considered as being originally a solar hymn that would be integrated later to the corpus of Book of the Dead. And then let's say that the title and the body of the text are not intrinsically connected. I don't say they are not, but they are not originally connected, so we must be quite careful by linking the title and the body of the text. Do you follow me? Finally, if the Great Game text and the Book of the Dead, of course, show the first prominent place of the Senet game in the afterlife, And yes, I agree, it's linked with the sun, but without overinterpreting this link, it remains nonetheless linked to pleasures. Again, the two being not at all contradictory, especially in Egyptian mind. And several texts, including this one, show that the dead sejaher when playing the senet. That is to say, he has recreation by playing the senet. A recreation that is linked to emotions, to satisfaction, and to intellectual concentration at the same time, as Yuri Volokhin has demonstrated in his very nice study of this expression. And not that this expression, sejaher, is used in other contexts than gaming, and remarkably also in love poetry, and especially in the papyrus Aris 500, where it designates sexual pleasure. So you have again a link, I mean, that has to be maybe a little bit more explored. So at the end of the New Kingdom, the very end of the New Kingdom, the representation of the Senet game in the chapter 17 disappears, then being replaced by the dead sitting in front of his offering table. And under the late period, the game is very, very rarely represented in a funerary context. Alors, of course, you might have in mind the two representations of Senet game in the tomb of Petosiris at Tuna El Gebel at the end of the 13th dynasty. So you see here the two gaming scenes with the deceased playing again an unknown adversaire, let's say. But for most commentators, in fact, these scenes are archaisms. Because at that period, you have archaisms in tombs. You take the model of old kingdom scenes to reproduce them in the tombs. And it might be more that than, in the end, something that would still reflect vivid beliefs, let's say, but under debate again. So in late period, the few Senet boards that are known are slabs. The boxes disappear entirely at the end of the New Kingdom. And by the way, at the end of the New Kingdom, the Senet boards also disappear from the dead trousseau. You don't find any Senet again in the tomb, at least as far as we know for the moment. And it's quite interesting in itself because at the same time, all the objects that are not strictly funerary disappear from the tomb. You only have strictly funerary objects starting from the 21st dynasty, like the stela, the statue, the coffin, whatever. And it's interesting in itself because it shows that if the Senet was that funerary, maybe it would have remained in the tomb, and it disappears. So from that time, the boards that are known are slabs, because the box disappears, as I said. Some of these slabs might be votive, we will see later. I'll try to speed up a little bit. I've taken too much time, I'm sorry. When some others are obviously used to play, like this one, and I think so, to the one that comes from Tel El Dafana, the case of these ones are quite interesting, because they were found in a Greek fortress at the time of Petri, so everybody was like thinking that these boards were testimony, let's say, from the ludic practice of Greek soldiers, but it happens that the building is not from the Greek time, but from the Said period, 26th dynasty, and quite recently it happens also that this fortress is not a fortress, but it's a storehouse for a temple. So you see that reconsidering sometimes archaeological data help to reconsider the games as well. So from the late period, and I really ask for your help for this one, we have three texts, three examples that have been discussed. First, Herodotus. I'm not even sure I copied the right the right passage in Greek. I don't read Greek at all, so maybe you can help. So in this passage, you have the King Rhampsinitus, so Ramses III, who plays against Demeter. Alors you see most translation I saw play dice, but I don't know if you agree or not on this. Yes, okay. And it's supposed to come from the chapter 17 of the Book of the Dead, because the scene takes place in the Hades, while deriving at the same time from a misinterpretation of the scenes of Ramses III playing the Senet in his harem. And some commentators think that the golden scarf here that Ramses III receives in Herodotus' text would be the lotus that one of the princes puts in front of the nose of Ramses III in the scenes of Medinet. Really, it's going a little bit too far for me, because the maybe, but maybe not, so I would not take that for granted at all. So you can see also that here the Senet is not quoted. There is no Senet that is mentioned there. Even if this text comes out all the time for the Senet studies. And the comparison is also often made with a second text, Egyptian, this one, the famous demotic tale of Setne the First, in which Setne would play three games of Senet against the dead Ninneferkapta in an attempt to gamble, let's say, the lost book of Thoth. You can see it's quite funny, by the way. They put before them the game board with its pieces, and they both played. Then Neferkapta won one game from Setna. He recited the spell to him, struck his head with the game box that was before him, and made him sink into the ground as far as his legs. Alors, I'm happy that you bluff, because we always have to find, like, a deep religious meaning. It goes further in the ground, etc. But it's a tale. Maybe it was just funny that he's beating with the box on the head better than winning, like, properly. I don't know. I'm just saying. You see that again, the Senet is not explicitly named. It's true that the box might go in that direction, but remember that the box has disappeared for 1,000 years now. Also, the fact that the game pieces are not called proper. I think Dr. Scheller studied that they are called UU ants, while the Senet pieces were called Iba, but a long time ago also, and maybe this UU, correct me if I'm wrong, might derive from Greek habit to name the pieces. In any case, you can see that the Senet is not quoted there, and I think it's wrong to take this text to say that the Senet is still funerary in late time with this text as a proof, because they don't name it. And I think we say that these texts speak about Senet because there is a funerary atmosphere in them with the Hades. So it's reversed again. I don't say they don't mention the Senet. I say they don't do it clearly, so we can't push the interpretation too far. And in fact, in the late time, it seems to me that the game goes to another direction, and this direction might be astronomy. So it's not new at all to say so. It has been put to all the studies that precede me. But I think it's really the big thing of the Senet. In late time, for the moment at least. Talking about astronomy, of course, everybody bears in mind Plutarch's account, according to which Hermes, corresponding to Thoth, plays against the moon to gain some of its light, and thus making the extra 5 days of the Egyptian year. And on the first of these 5 days, the god Osiris was born. So you have the text that is there. Okay, but does this link between the game, again, the game that is not quoted clearly, possibly the Senet but unnamed, and the moon existed in the pharaonic tradition, or is it a Greek addition? What is certain is that Thoth, lunar god and master of calendars, appears in the Great Game text, and as you can see, the first square is its house. And it also appears on other documents, like here, for instance, you see, do you recognize it? The god Thoth with his lunar crescent on his head. But what is quite extraordinary in this respect is that Ifao again keeps half of a superb document, superb senet, that is unpublished. In fact, it has been quoted in a very old article as an astronomic tablet, which is interesting in itself, but so ignored by in the Senate studies. And among various peculiarities, such as being made of black stone and being Osirian, totally Osirian, and not solar, let's see what we find in the square 27. So here, you remember in the square 27, we were in an aquatic environment, but here it's not the case, at least not on the first level. You have instead a representation of a god that is called Anshti, a god of Osiris that is mixed with Osiris. And you have there a quotation, hard to understand, but let's put it that way for the moment, master of the light that is in the moon, or master of the light that is the moon. So you have there all the elements of the Plutarch's account, the allusion to Osiris, the game board, of course, the moon, the light. So you have something there, I think, that really needs to be explored. And another point that could make this senet quite extraordinary is that from the first glimpse, and I've been discussed that with a historian of art also, it might be Ptolemaic. So from the body shape of the woman there, from also the forms of the signs, paleographic study needs to be done, but it might really be Ptolemaic, and we have no Ptolemaic senet that you can really date from Ptolemaic period. Petri has tried to, but was really like not for sure. And of course, knowing better on this one, dating it better could help to that, to date this one also, because it's made of the same material, a very beautiful senet board piece with this lion perching on the side. And of course, concerning astronomy, we could go also for the graffiti that stand on the temple roof of the late period, that have been considered as maybe used to track the phases of the moon on the temple roof. But again, these graffiti are not well known because they are not well covered in photographs, and they are not considered in their environment. They have to be considered with all the graffiti that surround them to understand them better. So that was a not so quick portrait, I'm sorry, of the senet. But Véronique told me I have time. and a rapid glimpse, let's say, on maybe few new questions and interpretation on it by looking at the documentation a little bit differently, maybe. And of course, many, many other questions would worth raising. On my side, I will focus on 3 points. First, exploring the ludic habits of non-elite group, meaning the one of Beren Medina, because I have access to it, so it would be a shame not to use this possibility. Second, redefining the actual situation of the Senet game in Egypt during the first millennium BC and during the Greco-Roman period. And as Dr. Schedler underlined, to study the possibility of a cultural transfer from Egypt to the Greco-Roman world that is not yet proven, even if a lot of authors see in each game scene with a board game in the Greek or Roman world, as long as it's funerary, something that could be a senet, but it's not sure at all. And I thank you for your time and your attention.
Thank you for the interesting presentation and very complete. I open the discussion. Mm-hmm. I think we have a few time.
Yes, we have time.
So if you have any question for this presentation and maybe for the last one, before we meet.
Yes. You said so much new It's so important for us to know revising the only standard work, which is by Piccione, which is already ancient, but not that ancient works are not good, but
no,
that, that new material is found.
Yeah. The thing is that I didn't say so, and by the way, if somebody has that, I would be so happy. There has been a re-edition of Piccione thesis in 07, and you can't find it at all. I mean, if you do on the Sudoc or things like this, it's in 3 libraries in the world. So if somebody finds that, I would be quite happy to see the way he has reviewed his own PhD thesis. No, nobody.
No,
you don't have that? No?
But did he contribute to having those board games in perspective?
Piccione, I'm not sure.
He has made a contribution, but he repeats what
he
knows.
The thing is that he and I really don't want to underestimate his work.
Because this was in 2007, so maybe it's a confusion.
No, there is something else. It's called Gaming with the Gods. And you can find on it's at Brills, and you can find on internet the reference, but it's just not to be found. So it's a big mystery. I don't know if you have not read it. I mean, nobody has read it, obviously. Sometimes it's quoted, but it's obvious that the author did not read, just to quote.
What is your view about Senet and the Greek games? Because you addressed this question to, and you made an interesting remark for us, reversing the thing, saying that the words to say horns, hounds, could come from Greece.
Well, it's not me, it's you. C'est pas moi. I think Dr. Schedler proposed that. It's not from me. It's not something that am I making wrong?
No, it is the term dogs is also used in the famous tablet that Irving Finkel published about the 20 squares game in the 2nd century BC.
But earlier, in Mesopotamia?
Yes.
Not Greece?
Yeah, no, in Babylon. Okay. Babylon. So this is obviously a common term.
But the thing is that in Egypt it was not that word, it was Iba, dancer. Which is interesting, by the way, because here, I did not say so, but it's always good to see, in the scenes, yes. Okay, so here you have the Senet game, and here you have the Iba dance. And the Iba dance is written with the gaming piece also, so there is really something that is intrinsically linked there, and they even show it.
And staying with this slide, you made me understand what Piccione meant by the game makes the links between the living and the dead, which was not very clear to me.
Yeah.
And you explained it quite well, comparing with offering tables, and but nevertheless, it's still not quite obvious.
What is not obvious?
The fact that it makes the links between the living and the dead.
What is
the representation, the collective representation, that you play with, there is a play between the two?
Yeah, the idea would be...
How does it work?
And Piccione explains that, and I think it's quite interesting, and at least we have material there. He thinks that maybe, if I understood well, mourners, or you know, could come next to the grave, do the senet, engrave it, and play it alone with the dead one. You see my point?
But you see how important it is, because we do not want to say it's similar, so it is the same. But when you find a board, miniature clay board game in the tranchée d'offrande, precisely before the tomb, not in the tomb, and with even a mourning character.
Yeah. I mean,
it's fascinating.
But it's really something that is not like, it's not sure at all, especially that this graffiti. Here there is this visual thing, and really it's striking. Nothing is by chance in ancient Egypt. The thing that it goes further means something. It's a link. And it's the very same thing when you have food offerings the bread there does the link, and we know that they were really deposited in the tombs. But it's just an idea, I mean, it's really just an idea, because this graffiti around the tombs, it's very difficult to date them, even if the grids look like what we know from what we suppose are Old Kingdom Senate games. But for sure, this link is clearly underlined in the coffin text with the spell 405.
And I didn't see well in the other scene, number 13, what is in the square really.
Here?
Yeah.
It's the same. It's you have the deceased, here the Senate board, here the player. But it's better on the drawing, I think.
And the player of the living ones.
We suppose that, but remember what I said just before, we suppose that at least it's a different world there than there. Here it's the world of the deceased. Here it's either a world that is the real world or idealized repetition of this world in the year after. So it's not very... It's not very clear. What I mean is that we have to be super cautious, and take one thing with the thing. As I said, I discovered this expression quite recently, to put the church in the middle of the village.
Yes. Does it follow? There are no rules, there are no fixations.
No,
that's
no.
True.
Any other remarks or... Oh. Questions?
I worked a little bit on the Egyptiaca in Greece during the archaic period, and you know that in Rhodes, at Felizos, there is on the deposit, archaic deposit of the Athena temple, there is some pieces of Senate. I'm not sure for the board. But,
you mean the playing pieces?
Yes.
But what do they look like?
What, sorry?
Or do we know there are Senate pieces? This is always the...
I have to have a look if we have the board or no. I think we are quite sure, but I have to see that.
It would be quite terrific, because to my knowledge, there is for the... To my knowledge, and I'm new in the game,
yeah.
There is no attestation of... For sure, Senet in the Greek world, no Roman. Mm. The fact that it goes through Cyprus, even if it's very different in its morphology in Cyprus, is quite interesting, of course. But and also, if I remember well, in Cyprus, it's played. It seems to be something for so-called lower classes. So it's everything seems to be quite different. And for the playing pieces, some of them are really like symptomatic of the Senate, and so. But you can also push stones, especially when you have super simple things. I suppose. So, I mean, if you have that.
Yes, I will look at.
Give it to me.
Another question.
Thank you very much for your interesting presentation. I wanted to go back to the passage from Herodotus.
Yeah, thank you.
Because as you said, if we are not, others is not like, for example, National Geographic or this kind of thing.
No, but it's not as wrong as we always say.
Because it's for the... I just wanted to have a look at it.
Yeah.
Because Sunku Bewin, for example, that could be to play with dice, but we have...
Can you show me on the screen where it is? I'm sorry, I don't read Greek, so I was a bit lost.
The second line, Sunku Bewin.
Okay.
It could be...
Kubos means dice, no.
Okay.
But at the same time, now a lot of analysts think that Sunku Bewin is not only play with dice, but also to gamble. So it could be also a reference to not precisely to a type of play, but to the function of this play. So we are gambling at some.
Mm. But the thing is about the gambling thing. The thing is that in the end. I mean, you see that Ramses III on Sinitus, okay, obtains something from the game, but it's not by winning. The text says he loses, then he wins, then he loses.
Yeah, so but this mention of lose and it could be in that direction.
But you gain something from a game that you don't win. So is it really gambling? Doesn't the goddess, for instance, rewards a brave adversaire? I don't know, I'm saying things like this.
Yeah, but it's just, like, just to say that that could be in classical Greek.
Okay.
Not only but, play with dice, but also with other things. But, and the other one is, it was that in Erotus we have also a complex system of translation, because it's not interested in giving information about Egypt. For example, in book 2, he says, we name this animal crocodilos, crocodile, but the Egyptian call it campsite. But it does not make this kind of operation everywhere. And so in this text, you have also other kind of translation. He says that they are speaking of Demeter, and so it could be also that behind Sucubeu could be an Egyptian play. And also,
it's
very difficult to...
But the thing with Herodotus, we never know where we... I mean, what interests me there, it's not what he might show from what the Egyptian might think. It's what a Greek regard on the Egyptian situation is. Even if Herodotus, I mean, it was very fashionable among Egyptologists to mock him. And in fact, when we go back to him, because sometimes you have to just wake up, oh, you have an eyewitness there, maybe you could go back to him a little bit. And we realized that he was quite often super right. So, and not only staging the differentiation in between cultures and etc.
But behind Sucubeu could be also cement or other kind.
Why not? I don't say it's not. But if it's as you taken like this, because I've read somewhere, but I don't know if it's true or not, maybe you can help me, that in very rare cases the Senet could be played with dice. But I have no example in mind, so because in that case, if we go against and if we translate the verb as playing dice, of course it doesn't work. I don't know.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Another question. I propose so to go downstairs and have a lunch
with the game.